Next, we invite Dr. Harpal Seli for managing the bone defects in distal femur.
A very good morning to the chairperson and all the colleagues sitting here at the outset. I'm really impressed with the organizational skills of the VASCON organizers. They've taken the step, I think, too far, very difficult to beat. So right away, I'll start. I've been given the task to deal with bone defects in distal femur, and I'll try to do justice within 7 minutes. So why a gap non-union topic was chosen? Just to give you an insight, this data is for 2010. And average cost of a distal femur fracture was about $10,000 in US in 2010. So by rough estimates, even if we say FD also doubles in 7 years, so this would be now about $20,000. A non-union where the first surgery, first revision is successful is about $25,000. In India, if we take it as $50,000, even if you use it Indian implant, but then if the cost of surgery is less, our population earns that much less as well and is not covered with insurance. So gap or a bone loss or a bone defect would add to the cost because the number of visits will increase, the number of procedures will increase. So that's the reason that is it becomes so much more important to us orthopedic surgeons when we deal with such patients. And then how do we define what is gap, what is bone loss, what is a bone defect? There can be either a structural defect, there can be a missing bone, or it could be a bone structural loss of the bone. Like in osteopenia or in osteoporosis, there can be, though the bone looks to be normal on X-ray, the length, the cortices are maintained, but there is structural loss. We are not dealing with that part. We are dealing with traumatic loss of a piece of bone or a segment of bone. That is what I will be dealing here. So what are the important things when we tackle such patients? It's soft tissue envelop, vascular supply, and infection. So you must consider these three things. I'm not going to go into a didactic lecture. I'll just take a few cases to show how these can be managed in different ways. These are the kind of fractures that we are dealing with. High velocity trauma, soft tissue envelope is ruptured, and there's comminution, there is bone loss, and these patients are usually young patients. 30-year-old male, head injury, lawyer by profession, had a EDH, closed fracture with intra-articular extension. It appears there's no bone loss, right? But when you go ahead and do a fixation, everything looks rosy. This area looks good, the middle segment. But when you open up for bone grafting, you realize what kind of bone loss you are looking at. Though the cortices look to be intact, and the treatment for these kind of fractures were popularized from this part of the country, Western India, that they went ahead and you keep on waiting, this fracture doesn't unite. And it was from this area that came that you need a medial support and a bone graft for this to unite. This is actually a hollow void, and to be very honest, sometimes single iliac bone graft, iliac crest, is less to fill up these patients. You have to put in either a plate on the medial side or a fibula along with to make these fractures unite. This is just the least of all. Let's start normally, and this goes on to union very well. Another patient from one of my colleagues, this is not my own X-ray, young female open fracture motorcyclist, landed up with a bone gap, open fracture, antibiotic spacer was put in, masculine technique was followed, Rhea aspirate was done, and within 6 weeks you can see some bone. At the end of 4 months, you can see a nicely uniting bone. So Rhea, though not available in India, but is very commonly used outside because it's least morbid. The morbidity of iliac crest graft is quite high, unlike we think. So this can be used. Another young male with bone loss, debridement, X-fix, spanning X-fix, antibiotic beads. You go ahead, put a fibula, and you add cancellous bone graft. Few months down the line, you can see there is consolidation of the medial cortex. Fibula is still standing proud. Mind you, these are the patients which will need protection for a very long time, because fracture of the fibula and fracture of the graft is known in these patients. So don't be in a hurry to proceed further. You can have delayed presentation like this. Patients managed, open fractures, bone visible through the wound. Young male, spacer was put, still the infection didn't control, was not controlled. I went ahead, put a Lizarov, did a, again a spacer, the infection healed well, did a corticotomy, started with the bone transport. Takes a long time. Reoperations are very common. You'll have pin infections, you'll have to change the pins. Sometimes you will lose the alignment of the limb, you have to correct that because of the stresses. Nicely goes on to union, the regenerate is consolidating, so you can well proceed further. Now last of all, an elderly male comes to you in this situation. 3 months down the line, it was an open fracture, debrided. In another hospital, was taken up for surgery to put internal fixation. When they opened up, they found purulent discharge, purulent collection. They abandoned the procedure and he landed up with us. This was the condition when he came to me. Hardly any options left, right? So I went ahead, put a Lizarov. Here I have done an acute shortening, because in a 75-year-old male, I am not going to do a bone transport. I do not want. He did not agree for amputation. So only way is acute shortening. I'll give him a shoe raise or think of it later on what can be done. The first is to achieve the alignment and to achieve reduction, achieve union, so that he is able to walk on his own foot. This is how it has consolidated over a period of time. He is now walking on his foot with a shoe raise, a block shoe. And so you can have complications. We lost the reduction on the way because there was loosening of the pins. You can have pin site infections, but that's how. So the bony ends have to be adaptive, viable bone, soft tissue, and in femur, maximum you can achieve, it is documented in the literature, is you can easily cause 3 inch of shortening without any functional loss to the limb. So I'll request you to please go through these articles who want to deal with bone defects of the distal femur. This is a very good editorial note. What to be selected, bone transport or induced membrane? The answer is not clear, but you have to choose what is best in your hands. And distraction osteogenesis is not a simple ball game. You must read up this article by Bhandari Gonadis et al. To know what are the complications, what are the problems faced by the patients who undergo bone transport in the distal femur. Let's all be gardeners rather than being carpenters. I wish to acknowledge support from my aortrauma colleagues, friends from OTA, my orthopedic department at DMCH, Professor Hans Kreder, who happens to be my mentor, and last of all, and the most important, my patients who give me an opportunity to learn while I treat them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Selly.